Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the annual EFG Hermes London Conference. In its seventh edition, we are extremely proud that this event is the largest investor conference held in the UK and EFG Hermes' largest investor conference to date. This year's conference boasts an expanded roster of represented countries, including 20 of the most compelling frontier emerging markets. The inclusion of companies from Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Georgia, Turkey, Uganda, and Vietnam is driven by our strategy to provide our valued clients with access to new markets in addition to MENA. Our sell-side clients are increasingly seeking opportunities in frontier emerging markets that will drive an interesting share of global growth over the coming decade. We hope that this edition of the conference offers an exclusive opportunity for the global investment community to add perspectives to their frontier and emerging markets knowledge, balance their respective risk and reward factors, and explore compelling investment opportunities with 130 presenting companies. We are delighted to have a strong lineup of speakers that have graciously accepted our invitation to speak, giving our buy-side and sell-side clients an opportunity to explore with key market regulators in two panel discussions centered on Frontier and Egypt. Chairpersons from stock exchanges including Nigeria, Kenya, and Pakistan are among the panel participants who will be with us tomorrow. But today, allow me to please to welcome Mr. Mohammed Farid, the chairman of the Egyptian Exchange and the Federation of the Euro-Asian Stock Exchanges. Mr. Farid is a true technocrat with a distinguished career, and he's here today to open a channel of dialogue with the investor base. Egypt has been lauded by the IMF for the successful execution of a major economic reform program, and the Egyptian Stock Exchange has recorded unprecedented levels well ahead of state-planned IPOs and will further reinvigorate the market. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here, and once again, welcome to the 7th Annual London Conference. I will leave the floor to Mr. Farid.
Good evening, everyone. It's always a pleasure to be doing a presentation over lunch. Probably everyone is always quite busy with lunch and would not be asking tough questions regarding the content of the presentations and everything. So I would like you to continue eating, and hopefully I can grasp your attention on the areas that I would want to grasp your attentions on. Again, it's a pleasure to be here in the EFG MS conference, and hopefully we will be presenting some of the developments regarding what has been happening in Egypt's economy on the various fronts. First of all, that we have short-term implications to what have happened. We have hopefully medium-term and long-term implications that should kick in, I would say, in the economy going forward. In addition to that, we're going to see some of the reform measures that we're aiming to implement at EGX to make your life easier, let's put it this way, and to make Egypt more attractive when it comes to investments in the area of capital markets. So, I hope this works. The starting point that we were at probably last year was severe, I would say, shortages of currency. We had the macroeconomic imbalances that we needed to deal with as an economy and the various players in the economy. The starting point for the macroeconomic imbalances that needed to be dealt with was number one related to the balance of payments deficit, or the macro, or the monetary policy policies that are being implemented. The second aspect of the macroeconomic imbalances that we were facing, I would say, during the past years was associated with the chronic and significant fiscal deficit that we have been facing in Egypt, partially to finance salaries and partially to finance all the spending that the government has been doing during the past years. And then the issue came to a point whereby you need to do reforms, and it was one way forward. The good point that reforms have been conducted in a way that could probably be irreversible, which is something good. So the starting point that happened when it comes to the monetary policy front to alleviate, I would say, the macroeconomic imbalance that occurred regarding the shortages in the foreign exchange was floating the foreign exchange currency. This in itself, I would say, unleashed some of the potential that we have been seeing during the months and prior to the flotation. But it wasn't only about the flotation. At the end, I would say the sin of all sins is about the fiscal deficit. The more you have fiscal deficit beyond your real economic growth rate, the more you would be seeing some issues associated with inflation, and hence it would impact as well your currency eventually and the balance of payments. So this had to be coupled with fiscal reforms that took place at that point of time. And again, the fiscal reforms were irreversible, let's put it this way. You started with a VAT law that was promulgated in September 2016. This in itself should add some revenues when it comes to, which is replacing basically the sales tax, and it extended some of the items that are being taxed from that perspective, and services as well. Services were not part of the sales tax law that was implemented, general tax that was implemented in Egypt. But these reforms, though unprecedented when it comes to the magnitude of the reform itself in terms of the size or leaving the market for the FX to be determined by supply and demand, and when it comes to the fiscal reforms and the budget deficit reforms, because it wasn't only about alleviating energy prices, it was stipulating for the first time in years a gradual increase of utility prices from electricity, gradual increases in water prices, all utility prices basically, with the VAT law, with the energy alleviation or the energy subsidy alleviation. All of this are unprecedented, but this without having, I would say, the social measures that would help, I would say, the less privileged or the most needy to overcome the hardship, because every reform has a price. Every reform has a price in the short term. And definitely, we are aware of this concept, and you're dealing with it. And hence comes the concept of the social security measures that have been introduced starting, I would say, years. It wasn't only a fact of the reform measures that took place, but before the reform measures, the bold reform measures that took place, you had some aspects associated with the social security issues that have been implemented. That's not the case. That's not only the case, basically. All of what you're doing is setting the stage for further reforms to have an impact on the real economy, to have an impact on companies, and hence you continued with reforms associated with the investment law itself by issuing a new investment law that is more conducive to business environment and that allows some of the tax breaks, and it eases as well a crucial point in Egypt, which was the dispute resolution, whereby all dispute resolution mechanisms have been stipulated in one place. Again, so that allows clarity for the various investors when it comes to this area. In addition to that, you had one of the most, I would say, difficult issues to deal with was the industrial licensing. You had a new law that industrial licensing at a certain point of time would be basically by notification, that factories would notify the relevant authorities with the required, I would say, licensing, and through this notification process, you will be able to obtain the required licenses to operate your businesses. So it was, again, reforms associated with the investment environment to facilitate or jumpstart the investment process in Egypt. All of this had definitely positive implications on the short term. When you get to look at even economic growth, we have been seeing a pickup in economic growth to reach the levels of 5% in the last fiscal year quarter in 2016-2017, and that's coming up from a rate of 3% or so. All of these figures are coming up from rates of 2% and 1.8% in the years prior to 2015-2016. So in itself, seeing growth rates picking up again to the 4% average during the last 2 years is a significant, I would say, reform measure when it comes to this area. But this, to be able to see these figures, you have to reform the energy sector significantly in Egypt. Prior to July, I would say 2014, and probably anyone who would have been visiting Egypt would have noticed the energy crunch that we had, the energy crisis that we had, and the lack of, I would say, power that has been happening prior to July 2014. Post-2014, the amount of investments that have been poured in the energy sector to produce sufficient electricity for the different players and the different manufacturers, that was a bottleneck that needed to be resolved. Otherwise, with a growth rate of 2%, we have been seeing this crunch. With a growth rates now of 4%, you don't see this crunch. So that was a crucial point that needed to be dealt with very swiftly starting in 2014. Again, you get to see as well the breakdown of the GDP growth. It's not only about consumption now anymore. Investments are kicking in. During, I would say, the 4 years between 2010-11 until 2014-15, consumption was the main contributor of growth. Net exports were dragging down, basically, Egypt's economy. But starting from the last quarter's data, you get to see that net exports are contributing positively from the one hand, and investments are contributing again. It came back again as one of the main contributing factors for economic growth in Egypt. When it comes to the various sectors as well, and that's a crucial point that would add to the benefits of Egypt's economy, is the level of diversification of the economy. There isn't a single sector that we rely upon in terms of our economic growth or our economic activity. Again, you have extractive industries are being represented in the economy by around 16%. You have the manufacturing sector represented in the economy by around 18%. You have the services sector, you have the wholesale and retail trade. You have every single, more or less, sector is being represented sufficiently in the economy. This is good because it helped, I would say, Egypt to waver its difficulties, and it adds to the diversification aspect for any investor when it comes to investing in the Egyptian economy. And we're going to see how this diversification is being represented as well in EGX in general. One of the advantages of picking up economic growth was associated with the unemployment rate that has been easing a little bit. I know that plenty of us could be saying that the figure itself of unemployment could not be that reflective, the official figures, but at the end what we're counting on is the general trend. The same measure of unemployment, despite not being that accurate from anyone's perspective, but again, this same measure used to tell us that unemployment is increasing. This same, I would say, metric measure or measure is telling us now that unemployment is a little bit on the decline in this regard. So the same measure that we are using, or the authorities are using, is telling us that unemployment is a little bit on the decline, thanks to the increased growth rates, I would say, that we have been witnessing during the past quarters, and specifically the last 2 years. And then we have the budget deficit. Again, as I mentioned, probably that's the sin of all sins when it comes to dealing with the macroeconomic imbalances and the macroeconomic aspects of any economy. The crucial aspects that needed to be dealt with are the issues that were very rigid in dealing with the government or with the budget in general. So one of the items that have been dealt with significantly, again, was the energy subsidies that had an impact on the budget deficit, to expect it to decline to around 10.5 in terms of estimates during the last fiscal year, 16-17, and that's coming from rates of 12.5% of GDP. That's quite a significant figure, given that the economy has been growing in real terms by around 4% during the last year, and this year would be again around the 4.1%. But having said that, what is a proper measure to be taken into account is the primary deficit of the fiscal deficit, the primary deficit of the government. Let's put it this way. That is the deficit not taking into account the associated costs with the debt aspect that the government of Egypt is seeing. This in itself have seen some surplus. That implies that the revenues, that tax revenues that are being collected, are exceeding. I know that I have told you to speak, but it's getting very high here. So the primary deficit itself is becoming actually not a deficit, it became a surplus in this regard. So that's helping significantly to finance, and hopefully with the projected decline in interest rates as a natural, development when it comes to interest rates. Interest rates are mean reverting in nature. You cannot see interest rates going on the upside all the time. Definitely they need to go to its mean, with the expected ease in inflation, again, that is going hopefully to happen during the coming months. We are expecting that the debt aspect in the budget deficit should be improving a little bit. Again, that's the breakdown to show us that the interest aspect is quite high this fiscal year. It makes sense. Interest rate cost has increased. You have been doing, unprecedented reforms that not every single country managed to do
all of these wave of reforms at the same point of time, and to manage to have the positive impact associated with these reforms that we're going to discuss on the other hand. Again, you get to see that income taxes have been on the rise. VAT yielded the required results when it comes to the revenues for the government. So again, that shows you are in the right direction when it comes to dealing with the government finances in the meantime. Of course, one of the prices that gets to be paid for any reform measure is a little bit inflation. We are all aware that inflation has been on the rise post, I would say, the flotation of the Egyptian pound. But it wasn't only about the flotation. It was about a flotation, a VAT implementation that added some percentages to the general sales tax that was paid. We're talking about energy subsidies alleviation. We're talking about utility prices alleviation. So all of this combined together had an impact and its toll on inflation. This has been coupled with, I would say, a budget deficit and excess liquidity in the economy for quite a number of period of years. It helped the inflation. However, again, inflation, as long as we're not seeing a spiral inflation, it is going to be on the decline. And one of the crucial factors that everyone needs to be seeing and monitoring is actually the monthly inflation figures that has been receding to its average numbers during the last months. So basically, average monthly inflation figures have been quite high during the period of the reform, which is understandable. But going forward, you get to see significantly monthly inflation figures are on the decline and reaching to its average inflation figures. Credit is still, I would say, significantly strong, but specifically when it is evaluated in the FX or the foreign exchange front, exchange rate is stabilizing. What an important factor to be taken into consideration is the net international reserves. One of the positive aspects of what has been happening is the portfolio flows, and this is the short-term gain. Short-term gains for, I would say, the bold macroeconomic reforms and the investment reforms that usually took place or takes place in any economy is to see immediately portfolio flows improving should these reforms be conducted properly, should these reforms be conducted on an irreversible basis. So this aspect has been significantly, I would say, commended by the various investors, and it has been witnessed as well when it comes to the investments in the fixed income market in Egypt. We're talking now about around $18 billion being injected in the government papers in this regard. The government have been successful on various fronts on several times to issue bonds in international markets and to retap the openings that they have been issuing in the market. In addition to that, it wasn't only about the portfolio flows, yet it is still lagging and it takes time to improve with the natural tendency and the natural cycle of the reforms and how the economy is being impacted. But still, you got to see improvement in the FDI figures, as we're going to see. You got to see improvement in the trade balance in terms of imports on declining a little bit, exports increasing a little bit, specifically in the last, I would say, few quarters. As we can see, the balance of payments have been on the rise or have been on the positive side during the last quarters for at least five quarters now, or four quarters since the more or less the flotation, which is helping again to build the required, I would say, reserves to support the dynamics of the Egyptian economy when it comes to various fronts. That's another point to show that you have some diversity as well when it comes to your sources of capital. It's not only about portfolio inflows that came. You have workers' remittances that rebounded again after a period of, I would say, stagnation. It rebounded significantly in the last quarters. And then you have still exports that are contributing. You have the Suez Canal contributing to your revenue base, to your sources of revenues in this regard. I just want to leave this for you, because basically, that's the story of Egypt. Every single time we do reforms at the trough period, the economy and the markets respond nicely for 6 to 7 years. So that's the ultimate point. And this time, the reforms that are being conducted are quite unequivocal. Indeed, there isn't a single time, despite you have gone through the waves of reforms. This is not the first wave of reform that took place in Egypt. We're talking about waves of reforms that took place in 1991, 1992, with a trough I would say, economic growth of 0.3% of GDP. And at that point of time, with the reforms that has been conducted, from monetary policy reforms, from fiscal policy reforms, from investment and business sector reforms, by improving and increasing, I would say, the number of flotations in the market and reactivating the capital markets in Egypt, you got to see the economy responding nicely for 5 years until there is a shock that is happening. An internal shock, but until I would say that point of time, you get to see the economy responding nicely. Again, in 2003, 2004, from the trough figures of the 3.2% at that point of time, 2002, 2003, with the reforms that took place in Egypt, the second wave, I would say, of reforms, you get to see the economy responding nicely until basically the financial crisis and the aftermath of the revolutions that occurred in Egypt. And I would say now we are in the third wave of reform, which is by far bolder, much stronger, and actually more far-reaching, and taking into consideration some of the aspects that have been missed in the previous reforms, mainly associated with the social security aspect or social safety nets for the less privileged people that has not been accounted for maybe previously. We believe that everything going and the government continuing in its reform plan, things should be going on the right direction when it comes to economic growth, when it comes to job creation, when it comes to the diversity of the economy going forward. Definitely there will be hiccups, definitely there will be some aspects that would need to be dealt with on an ongoing basis, and that's the nature of any economy and how to deal in, I would say, in terms of a macroeconomic policy setting and sectoral setting. This is just the picture of Bursa Alexandria in the 1980s. So I would like to move a little bit to EGX itself, trying for you to know. This is basically EGX. We have 148 brokerage companies. We have 254 listed companies. That part of these listed companies are being here presenting themselves to the various investors. We have exchange-traded funds, so we are as well quite diversified in terms of, I would say, some of the indices tracking the Egyptian economy. We have been one of the fastest growing markets since June 2013. This is basically the role of capital markets. It's about going to basics again. The role of any capital market is twofold, actually. It's about price formation. That's the most important thing. At the end, the role of any capital market is to be able for or to enable investors and to enable companies to be able to price their product correctly, and that's the crucial aspect that any, I would say, stock exchange. But in itself, this should not be a target without going to the other aspect of any exchange, which is back to basics, the capital formation. Companies that require funding should be resorting to capital markets, and these are exactly the figures that have been happening in Egypt during the past years, between capital increases of around 120 billion, between acquisitions of this magnitude, between IPOs of a value, and we're going to see some of the new IPOs coming very soon to the market in the coming months and weeks. This is the market capitalization of the Egyptian exchange by sector. This is just to show you that, again, the diversification of the economy is being represented partially as well in the diversification of the listed securities or the listed companies in Egypt. So that's an aspect to be taken into consideration, why EGX is, I would say, a location for investment. This is the distribution of investors. We have been seeing a significant, I would say, activity when it comes to foreign investments post the flotation in November 2016. That's another aspect to show some of the data that are public information regarding the valuations in the Egyptian market in general, having an average PE that is below, I would say, the average PE of other equivalent markets in the region. In terms of the MSCI compared to the first, I would say, beginning of the year in 2016, we're one of the countries, one of the markets that have been doing quite well on various aspects. But it's not only about this, it's about what's going on in the future. That would be the entire target of the reform plan. Again, to be able to finance growth, to be able to see the economy growing significantly, you would need financing for this growth. You need financing for companies. And hence, the role of capital markets is being, I would say, enhanced in this regard. And there are some of the reforms with the aim of increasing the turnover ratios to enable investors to be able to price. Again, pricing of the securities is quite an important aspect. So we need to enhance, we are working on enhancing the market liquidity on various fronts, from introducing some new instruments such as short selling, hopefully, and some of the other aspects that we're trying to reform when it comes to intraday trading and margin trading. So, and derivatives, hopefully, at a certain point of time after introducing all of this. But again, all of this with the proper disclosures, and this is something that we're working extensively again with the listed companies. Various companies, we're working very hard with them. We're doing a fortnightly meeting with meetings amongst all the research houses and the required companies for them to be able to present the disclosed information in a proper way to improve the communication with investors like your good self. Financial literacy is quite important in the market, and I believe without having proper financial literacy and accordingly financial inclusion, financial literacy should yield to some aspects of financial inclusion. The sustainable, I would say, reform plan that is being aimed at would not be as sustainable as hope. Financial literacy is quite an important aspect for that. We're taking it seriously in the Egyptian stock market. All kids basically learn biology, all kids basically learn chemistry, all kids basically learn mathematics, but are not being taught proper finance during their early years. And that's one of the areas that we would like to push significantly. We're going to further develop some aspects in the over-the-counter trading platforms that are being presented in Egypt. Repositioning the SMEs. SMEs are quite important, or the SMEs market in Egypt, which is the Nilex. SMEs are very important to the Egyptian economy when it comes to numbers, at least. Their contribution to employment as well is quite high. And part of the aspects that we need to be taken into consideration, that Nilex is a platform for growing capital. It's a platform for companies that would like to grow and to increase, their financing opportunities and to diversify their financing opportunities for the various their investment opportunities that, or growth opportunities that are having. And that's another area that we're going to work hard with the various players in the market to reposition, I would say, this market to be a growth capital market rather than an exit market in this regard. And again, I'm happy that I'm speaking over lunch. Everyone is eating, so basically I don't think anyone would have any questions. I'm done here with the presentation, and thank you. Enjoy your lunch.
I suppose I should really start with the words or the phrase in a change to the advertised schedule. What I would like to say is thank you very much for everybody coming again, showing your continued support in what seems to be a bigger and hopefully a better event every single year. What I would like to do now is offer my personal thanks to Mr. Mohammed Farid for taking some time out of his extremely busy schedule. I think that had he decided not to come, I'm not sure we could technically call it a panel discussion with only me as a moderator, and I would be in a little bit of trouble. So thank you once again.
Thank you.
I think some of the questions that I have, picking up from the presentation of Mr. Farid, are applicable across all of the exchanges, and I think it's important to look at the situation of not where exchanges have been over what has been a very changeable time in the last decade, but where we can perhaps look to go to from here. So I'd just like to start with a few more detailed points on organizational structure, market developments, and so on. Mr. Farid, on the topic of investable markets, investability has become a much used word amongst the community, particularly in light of the significance of passive funds and the management of the indices that they track. In addition to specific criteria used by index providers such as FTSE and MSCI, the overall concept of investability is considered to have some weight, and feedback from clients is usually sought in this regard. How do you feel your market fares in terms of overall investor experience, and do you feel there has been any improvement in recent years?
Well, the first answer that would come to my mind, we're faring well, let's put it this way. But this does not mean that there isn't, I would say, efforts that needs to be conducted for the investability aspect to improve, among which would be the main, I would say, liquidity and the size of the market itself that should be, I would say, dealt with and tackled. Part, I would say, of the positives or the positive implications of the macroeconomic reform plan that have, or the economic reform plan that have been partially implemented, would be to improve the economic conditions and the enabling environment for companies to start coming to EGX itself and would want to increase either their, I would say, current shares that are being presented in the market or being floated in the market, or new listings that would come. And this would have only happened if they are optimistic towards the future in this regard. So we are faring, I would say, relatively speaking, well, but definitely we need more efforts when it comes to the size of the market itself. We need to improve it as much as possible and to increase the liquidity and turnover ratios for the market to make it even more investable to foreign investors.
I see. We've seen from your presentation that Egypt has 254 listed companies. Of those, 40 meet the minimum size reference for global investor indices. But Egypt only has 16 companies in global indices. That includes small, mid, and large caps. This is due either to free float or liquidity issues. Do you have any plans to tackle that to make the market more investable?
One aspect would be the implementation of the listing requirements that stipulates explicitly that there should be a minimum threshold for the number of shares to be listed or the free float, basically, of companies. So this, I would say, implementation via promoting the benefits of increasing the number of shares, and that would improve the company's, I would say, image and valuations in front of the various investors. From that aspect, we're trying hard to increase the implementation and to achieve the target of increasing the free float of the various listings. On the other hand, part of, again, the success of the macroeconomic reform is to see companies willing to list and willing to resort to capital markets. But add to that, you get to see as well the government planning to have an IPO program to be for listing of the various, some of the state-owned enterprises in the market. This again should help a little bit improving the number of companies that can be on international indices, given the sheer size or the magnitude of the companies that are going to be listed. It's not a secret the first wave of companies should come from the oil and gas sector, from the Ministry of Petroleum, and currently there are one or two companies being dealt with from the processes and the valuations and everything in this regard. But all of this, if it is not coupled with proper trading venues, flexibility for investors to deal with in and out, and having the various opportunities to trade in whatever direction they aim, then we'll still be having some issues when it comes to the turnover ratios or the liquidity ratios that we get to see in the market. So it is about coupling both together to improve. But at the end, we need to look at the entire value chain, honestly speaking. It's not only about tackling a single aspect or having a single reform plan when it comes to the listings. You need to look at the quality of companies and the quality of disclosures that are being presented to investors. And here we have, I would say, a spectrum of disclosures that are being presented. Some of the companies, among which here are plenty of them, are very good in their disclosures, and this improves the visibility and supports, I would say, the research houses to conduct their own research. And by having, I would say, company coverage of these stocks, it improves automatically the exposure and the potential to be listed in some of the sectors. This is from the supply side, of course, with attracting new sizable companies to be listed in the market and hopefully significant parts of it to be floated as well, not only about a small percentages. And then you look at the trading venue and I would say opportunities to increase the turnover from that aspect. And the third part of the value chain is the demand side. Part of definitely, I would say, the efforts is associated with I'm seeing investment banks like your good self here, with increasing the awareness about the market and increasing, I would say, the knowledge about the market and the Egyptian economy. But another area would be trying to advocate with institutional, domestic institutional investors to increase the appetite, because this is part of the aspect when it comes to private pension funds, public pension funds. One of the aspects that needs to be, I would say, tackled in a serious way.
Thank you. You touched on my next point briefly there. Market cap in Egypt is 15 to 20% of GDP, which is well below regional and emerging market peers. You mentioned that there have been some IPOs and there are some forthcoming. And I think there is already diversity amidst the sector, but what we've seen recently is some of the IPOs have been reasonably small size. Do you think you might be able to give us a bit more detail about privatization plans, negotiations with government-related entities for perhaps the future pipeline of some larger issuance?
Usually, and probably history repeats itself here, the starting point for the government is to go with a safe bet, let's put it this way. So when it comes, when we remember 2004, 2005, the starting point again was with one of the oil and gas companies that was very successful in its flotation. So it has to be sequential. This is what we are basically discussing with the government, that we need to start, we need to have a pipeline of IPOs. They are eager as well to activate the market from that perspective. They know that activating the capital markets is an enabler for the reform plans that they are doing. It will have to go through its own sequence of having a pipeline, starting with some of the companies in the oil and gas field that are quite ready for the IPO program. And there are immediate and immediate needs for the funds being used from the flotation. So that's a crucial point again when it comes to dealing with the government. Another aspect that after the success of, I would say, the starting point of these companies or with the companies, you will get to see some sizable companies being floated in the market, hopefully, to finance an important aspect, again, the budget deficit that has been looming around for quite a number of years. The exact, I would say, companies apart from the oil and gas, I don't think we'll be able to disclose it in details, but there are some sizable companies apart from the oil and gas, the initial oil and gas companies, that hopefully could be a potential for listing in the market and would have significant sizing as well when they come to the market.
You did mention briefly pensions. I think it'd be interesting for everyone to hear a bit of an update on the status of the local asset management industry. And are there any particular plans within the pension sector, whether it be private or public, to further invest in the equity market?
In pensions in Egypt, we have a dual system, more or less, where you have the public pension systems that is run by the state or run by the government, and you have the private pension funds that are being privately run by local entities. So whatever company, they can have a private pension fund on their own, or entity can have a private pension fund. Definitely both of I would say, of these entities or group of entities are required to get to know more about the capital markets and the investing opportunities. The ultimate aspect of pensions, that they are deep in pockets and they have long-term targets. They are not prone to the volatility, the short-term volatility that is being seen in the market on the various fronts. So an important aspect would be working with the regulator in promoting one of the regulatory frameworks that has been issued previously to mandate the pension funds to have professional certificates to for their investment management department or the investment management area, or to hire a proper, I would say, and certified, I would say, fund management or investment management company. So we'll be working hard with individual, I would say, private pension funds and public funds as well to work in this regard. An important point that I would like to add, in Egypt, you need to go granular. You cannot do reform plans from, I would say, a high level. You need to go to the level of details whereby you can try to convince every single aspect or every single player in the market with the benefits of having long-term investments
in this area to increase eventually the size of institutional investors being presented in Egypt.
Okay, thank you. One aspect of investment within the region that I see or do not see specifically is that from Asian investors. And despite the fact that Middle East markets have become an important subset of frontier and look to become more important with regards to emerging markets with the widely anticipated inclusion of Saudi Arabia in EM indices, it is very noticeable that activity from investors based in Asian markets remains relatively weak. Is that something that you have addressed? Is that a pool of liquidity that you would like to pursue?
It is definitely one of the pool of liquidities that I would say that the main issue of tackling this pool of liquidity was trying to deal with it as a collective pool, or let's put it this way, they perceive the entire area as a collective pool when they deal with the various, I would say, players or the various markets. They deal with it from an aggregated perspective, the MENA region, for example. So one of the important aspects that we would like to tackle, and it is definitely one of the pools that we would like to go for, would be trying to showcase them that there is a separate story for each market. And definitely we'll be discussing the Egypt story when it comes to presenting the case. It is of paramount importance definitely to start tackling this liquidity pool to increase the diversity and the appetite for these players to invest in the market.
Okay. One thing that is often mentioned by many exchanges around the region is new products and new developments. And there seems to be a feeling that other exchanges in the region could be accused of running before they could walk with the announcement of derivatives, short selling, stock borrowing and lending. Whilst relying upon what is essentially a retail legacy platform, which is unable to accommodate such products. What plans do you have to develop these products of your own based on platforms of a global standard?
The starting point that probably even I might have been put it by mistake in my presentation is the word new.
Sorry to interrupt you. Ladies and gents, the background noise is getting a little bit high. I was wondering if perhaps we could just lower it a little bit. I know the acoustics are a bit poor, but I think some people are having difficulty in hearing what's currently being said. Thank you.
The starting point would be, that's better, I have to say. The starting point would be, and probably it was one of the mistakes to be putting it in the presentation as new. What's the definition of new? I mean, short selling has been there for ages, decades. Derivatives, the same concept. Whatever product you're talking about is not new anymore. So it's about trying to adopt some of the products in the market. So that's a crucial point, because it's not that we're talking about something very exotic to be traded in the exchange. We're talking about plain vanilla derivatives that we're aiming at, or we're talking about a normal short selling rather than any something that could be complicated beyond the normal complications that could be perceived regarding short selling. That's just in the outset, basically, that it's not new anymore. I mean, everyone, more or less, in terms of developed markets or even the main emerging markets, have these products being available in their markets. When it comes to EGX, the starting point that we needed to work on is to facilitate and increase the level of trading in the market. When I was appointed in August, last August, the average trading value that we have been seeing was between 400 million per day EGP. I'm talking about Egyptian pound as well. Between 400, 500 million. Now we're talking about a range that could go from 1.3 or 1.2 billion Egyptian pounds to 1.8 billion Egyptian pounds per day. And that's in that period of time that we have been seeing. One of the immediate measures was to facilitate the process of the continuous trading. We had a circuit breaker that used to take 30 minutes per individual stock once the price reaches the limits that the circuit breaker kicks in. And it was basically the longest time ever in the world for any exchange. So one of the reform measures that we conducted immediately was to reduce, I would say, the circuit breaker time from this 30 minutes to the 15 minutes window. Another area that you need to improve with the liquidity being present in the market and the turnover is to work on intraday trading, I would say, facilities that we do have in the market by allowing it to be more freely for investors. We're doing some, I would as well, propose changes when it comes to margin trading and the percentages that are allowed for investors to trade in. So all of this, I would say, incremental reforms. There isn't a big bang that you can do in any stock market. You have to do a series of incremental reforms that collectively create the required change and dynamism in the market. But the ultimate point is the ease of entry and exit in the market is a crucial point. By having the stage being set by doing these reforms, we should be ready for introducing the new aspect again, I'm saying it by mistake, which is the short selling. And hopefully after the short selling, given that short selling is a prerequisite for derivatives, would be derivatives afterwards. When it comes to the trading platforms currently in Egypt do provide or do cater for these, I would say, instruments with the intricacies and the requirements of the regulator when it comes to uptick rule and zero tick rule for the short selling. When it comes to the post-trade, I would say, settlement procedures and all of this aspects, it is fungible enough to be changed in case it is deemed not, I would say, that conducive for these areas. But the ultimate target is we need to have a start to be able to figure out what are the things that would need to be amended and move from that perspective and move from that point forward to be able to have, I would say, various investment opportunities or various products in front of investors. This would be coupled with significant, I would say, education aspects for the various new products that are being introduced in the market, and to enable as well the various institutional investors, either domestically or internationally, to be able to work with these, I would say, financial instruments to hedge their position, to increase their exposure by increasing their beta regarding whatever exposure they're seeing in the market. So it is a plan to have going, I would say, on incremental reforms, and hopefully the aggregated or the entire plan would yield positive results on that front. All of this would be coupled as well with a target of having a commodity exchange in the market that basically we were, according to some of the historians, we were the fifth most active combined exchange, Cairo and Alexandria, in the 1940s. And that is mainly driven by the derivatives exchange that was being established in Alexandria, as I have been showing. So this, I would say, is not new to Egypt. We were, I would say, leading in this area. So a commodity exchange, either on the spot front or the futures front or the derivatives front, is part of the plan again during the coming years to see it in place and to enable as well not only financial investors but to enable the real sector players. Any manufacturer that is operating in the market that would need to hedge part of his risk by adopting some of the instruments that are being provided to be able to use these instruments properly, basically, to hedge the risk. I know that's an ambitious plan, but there has to be a starting point to work with these, I would say, or to try to implement this reform plan, and we take it from that perspective. All of this within the context of supporting the macroeconomic or the economic reform plan that has been implemented on the macroeconomic front, and then you need to boil down from the macroeconomic front to the sectoral front, and every single sector that we're talking about is requiring sufficient funding or requiring funding for growth from, I would say, transportation sector. Any new projects that are going to be implemented in Egypt in the transportation, logistics, and so on would be requiring funding. Any manufacturing sector, the same concept. So basically, all of this is feeding in the main agenda of providing and facilitating the fundraising in the Egyptian market.
Thanks very much. Sorry to cut in there. We're approaching our time limit, so what I would quickly like to do is to throw open the floor to any questions, either based on our discussion here or on the presentation that Mr. Fried gave earlier on. Is there anyone that would like to ask Mr. Fried any specific questions?
I'll take it that this is a good sign, okay. So basically that everyone is happy with what has been presented, and that's it. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.